All right, let's try and actually create some code that calls an API that someone else has written. And this is the sort of thing we frequently end up doing in our code. Maybe it's somebody in our company has written and stored as a web service, or maybe we want to call a web service that someone at a different company has created for us, but does some neat functionality that we'd like to leverage. So in this case, I want to call the analyze image, which is part of a cognitive service in Azure. So if I bring up the documentation, and remember, it's often going to come back to go look for the documentation, do a search. It tells you how to first create the service, because remember, I'm going to need that key so that I can call it. And the way you do that with this particular one is you have to create the service first. And in this case, that does mean I need an Azure account. So there are tutorials that tell you how to go create your account for free and create the cognitive services resource. So I already have my Azure account, and I've already logged in at portal.azure.com. So I've gone to the Azure page, and then I say, I find the easiest way if I know what I'm creating. And in this case, I want to create, because I know that Analyze Image is part of the Computer Vision API. So I've already logged into the Azure portal at portal.azure.com. And because I know from the documentation that I need to create a Computer Vision API, I can just go to the portal, and I find the easiest thing to do to actually go and do a search for computer vision, and you'll actually see it pop up computer vision rather than digging my way through all the submenus to find the one I want. And I click on computer vision, and it says, oh, you must want to create a computer vision API. Yes, I do. Thank you. That's how I'll get the key and the address I need to call it. And let's give it a name, and let's just call this playing Python. Image analyzer. So I'm writing this little, I'm going to write Python code that's going to pass an image and it's going to analyze the image for me. You do have to have a Microsoft subscription. I'm just going to pick my Visual Studio subscription here. Now, the address is going to depend on where you have the service created. So the way Azure works in the cloud is when you create a service, you actually get to pick which data center it's stored on. So you want to pick one that's fairly physically close to where you are at the moment. I live up in Canada, so I might pick Eastern US, or there are some in Canada as well. And then the pricing tier, you'll notice there is a free tier. F, in this case, is the free version. And for what I'm doing, the free tier is going to be perfectly fine. A lot of times when you just want to try something, you can try it for free, and you only have to go to a paid version when you're doing something in production. And then the resource group. A resource group is kind of like a file folder which keeps your stuff together. So when you're creating multiple resources in the cloud, multiple services, you can put them in one resource group, and that way you know where they're all located to delete them or modify them later. So I actually, let's just create a new resource group called Resource Group Python Fun. So I'm just going to create a new one. And then if I do anything else later, I'll just keep it in that same resource group. So think of it kind of like a project folder. So I can create that. And then what's going to happen is it's going to create that subscription. But for the sake of simplicity, I have already got one that's created. Once it's done, I can actually go to my all my resources, and I will actually say, whoops, no, I don't want to leave that. Thank you very much. It is validating. Oh, it's still checking to make sure it's good. Okay, there we go. So it's going off and creating that service for me. Now, once it's created the service, I want to go to the overview page. That's the most important page for me to be able to call it. Because what'll happen is when I go to the resource and I go to overview, it'll tell me the address of where that service is located and the key I need to call it. Remember, those were two of the things I needed to call a service. So here, the endpoint, that's my address. So in this case, I picked East US, so it's eastus.api. That's how it knows which of the various addresses. Remember all the different addresses we saw here? The one that you use depends on where you create the service. And here we have that manage keys. So if I click on show access keys, it will actually give me the keys here, and I'll be able to copy and paste them. There we go. It's two different keys I can choose from. Doesn't matter what you use. And I can just copy that. And when my code, when it asks me the key, that's the key I'll put into my code. All right. So now I have a web service ready to call. Now I need to go to my Python code and actually call it, see something happen. So what I've done here is I've got some code, and I'm just going to walk you through it. And this is in the GitHub repository, so you'll be able to download a copy of this code, play with it yourself, create your own service, and explore it. This is one you really want to spend some time playing with. you'll see some familiar commands. I'm importing that request library. That makes it easier for me to make my HTTP calls from Python. I'm importing another one called JSON. I'm going to talk more about JSON in the next module, but the data that comes back from the service I called is in format called JSON. So I'll talk more about that next module, but I just need that for holding the results come back. I've already copied and pasted my subscription key over. That I'm going to need to have so that Azure knows I have permission to call this analyze image. I have my address. This is from a service I created earlier, so the address is different than the one we just showed. But that's the address of the service I created. And the address in this case, you also have to specify that it's analyze, because this is the address of the computer vision API, and I need to specify that I want to call the analyze function of the computer vision API. How do I know that? Guess what? You know a way I know that? It's because I looked at the documentation. So you can see here that when you call it, you'll see here it says request URL, you'll see it says analyze. So here's the address, the only thing that changes is the server name, and analyze is the name of the method. So always in the documentation I find this stuff out. Let's go back to our code. Keep going through and see what else we can figure out. So we have the address, so we know where we're calling. We have the function name. Now we have the parameters we want to pass into the function, because anytime you call a function, you have to pass in the right parameters. So I need to pass in, what are the parameters? Back to the documentation, visual features, a string indicating what visual feature types to return. Multiple values should be separated by commas. Valid values include. So this is basically saying, when I ask this function to analyze an image, I have to tell it what information I want back. Do I want to know the colors that are in the image, a description of the image, if there's faces in the image, what objects are in images, or tags that are in the image? So I've chosen to say, give me back a description and the color. So those might be the ones. You could add more, take away less, and change those. And I've also decided that I would like to have it back in English. So I would like, if it says there's a bear, I want the word bear in English. So I've specified my parameters. Now, in this case, I have to pass in that actual image that I want to analyze. So I actually have a subfolder that I've created on my computer, and I'll have that in the GitHub for you as well. And it's called a polar bear. So it's just a picture of a polar bear, actually, if you'd. And if I open it up, I can put that into an image object. So I'm doing some Python here. This is a little bit new. If you look up, this is the open command. It allows you to open a file and put it into an image object. So I can pass that image to the function. Now I also have to pass in those HTTP headers. That was something else I had to do. And in this case, what do I pass in? Check the documentation. What do I need for the headers? There we go. I need the content type. And the content types can either be JSON, or octet stream, or multi-part form data. These are the content types I can choose from. And basically that just indicates, am I passing the image as here's the address of the image on the web, or no, here's the actual image. And if you're passing the actual image, that's octet stream. So you'll notice my content type is set to octet stream. The key is the key that I entered earlier. I've just put it there. And by the way, right now I've just put the subscription key in the code. Not a best practice. I'm doing it so you can follow my code and play with it. But if you had that key, if I kept this key and you knew it, you could call it and call the web service and I'd be the one paying for it. Not the way I want things to work. You basically using, it's like me giving you my house key. You can come to my house and open the door. If I give you my API key, you can go to this API and pretend you're me. So I don't want to do that. I want to protect it. Christopher's going to show you the right way to store your API keys in an upcoming module. So make sure you watch that one. So now I have all the information I needed. I have the address. I have the headers. I have the parameters. Now I'm ready to call this web service out there somewhere, well, on the data center. So I call request.post. And I pass it the address. I pass it the headers. I pass it the parameters. And I pass it the data that I've just set up. I've got an extra line of code here that I find is really useful. What this raise for status does is it basically says, if and when I call that web service, something weird happens and I get an error, please raise an exception so I can handle it just like any other Python error. Because that allows me to do my try finallys and things like that in my code, which you learned in the error handling. So that allows it to raise the errors like an exception in my code. So I can handle it the normal way. And all I'm going to do for now is I'm just going to display the results on the screen. Don't worry too much about this code. We're going to talk more about JSON shortly. But if I'm lucky, then when I go here now, all that code, but what's amazing is when I'm done, call api.py, and hopefully, it's now actually going off to a server somewhere out there, checking my key, making sure I have permission, passing in the image, and coming back and saying, hey, here's a bunch of information about that image. Wow. All right, we've successfully called a web service. How to understand that data that came back? We'll cover that in the module on JSON.